Our debt to the heroic men and valiant women in the service of our own country can never be repaid. They have earned our undying gratitude. America will never forget their sacrifice. President Harry S. Truman. Every honor flight has its own personality, its own magic. Each is as different as the weather in May, August, and October. But some things are as predictable as misty eyes at Arlington National Cemetery and a longing to linger at the Iwo Jima Memorial. There's the look of surprise and disbelief on the faces of veterans when they're greeted with fire engine water arches, salutes, bands, hugs, and spontaneous gratitude from strangers. There's the sadness and heartache that passes over like the shadow of a cloud as memories come flooding back at the World War II Memorial. And there's the question that comes up over and over on every flight. All this for us? At 5:15 a.m., Cincinnati still sleeps. Highways that will soon be choked by rush hour traffic are all but empty, but a dozen veterans have already gathered at Cincinnati Northern Kentucky International Airport, and reinforcements are on the way. The Honor Flight Day is about to begin. Some of the World War II and Korean and Vietnam veterans have been up for hours, coming from local suburbs and cities throughout Southwest Ohio and Northern Kentucky, even as far as Louisville, Dayton, and Lexington. They're dressed comfortably in khakis, loose jeans, and slacks. They wear gym shoes, mall walkers, and lace-up boots. A few pull on their Honor Flight t-shirts over sport coats or sweatshirts. Their baseball caps don't advertise colleges or golf courses. Their favorite teams are Army, Navy, Air Force, USMC, often embellished with gold scrolling and unit insignia that name specific divisions, battles, or ships. Many carry canes. More than a dozen roll past in wheelchairs and are escorted to the front of the room. As each veteran arrives, they're given a name tag and t-shirt that says Honor Flight Tri-State on the front with another message on the back. If you can read this, thank a teacher. If you can read this in English, thank a veteran. The men who were drafted or enlisted to fight World War II in the 1940s are now in their late 80s and early 90s. Korean War veterans on the Honor Flight are not far behind, limited by age and infirmities. Most have not been very far away from home in months or even years. Many have never been to Washington, D.C., and those who have been there often say they haven't been back since they were soldiers, sailors, airmen, or young parents. Some veterans have not been on an airplane in years. A few have never been on an airplane. As the flight assembles, there are 70 veterans, 70 guardians, 3 medics, 5 board members. Faces of the veterans are pale and uncertain. Heads droop. Shoulders are hunched as if warding off a chill. They look a bit lost and confused, unsure what to expect, uncomfortable so far away from the security of familiar surroundings and reassuring routines. Near the check-in tables, TV reporters with varnished hair and catalog model suits do stand-up interviews as their cameramen roam the crowd. Big band music and service hymns from the 1940s play on the speaker system. Commercial airline passengers just around the corner crane their necks to see what's going on as they wait in lines for airport security screening. By 5:45, dozens of rows of chairs are nearly filled, and volunteers who paid their own way on the flight as guardians are making their first contact with their assigned veterans and getting acquainted. Where are you from? Where did you serve? What branch of the military? What was it like? Family members who came to participate in the Honor Flight opening ceremony and see off the flight stand around the edges, filling the open spaces around the chairs as they snap pictures with phones and pocket cameras. The Guardians were briefed a week ago about what to expect, and everyone is ready for the trip that most veterans have waited decades to take, to finally visit the memorials that were built in their honor in Washington, D.C. Many veterans are traveling with a son, daughter, grandchild, or other family member as their guardian. Everyone on the flight has been assigned to one of three color-coded buses they will board after landing in D.C. The excitement is contagious and the crowd waits. The welcoming ceremony is about to begin. At 6 a.m., the buzz of the crowd grows quiet, silenced by the soft, keening cry of bagpipes in the distance. Gradually, it draws closer. Even the TSA lines come to a halt as travelers stop and stare as the rugged pipers in kilts and sashes march past. The pipes send an electric chill through the crowd as the procession comes into view, as solemn and dignified as their haunting music that echoes from ancient battles, raising the hair on the neck and bringing old warriors to their feet. There's a call to stand for the pledge, but the veterans are already on their feet, grabbing their hats off their heads as the rest of the crowd hesitates, then gets the cue and follows the lead of the veterans. A TSA color guard leads the way for the pipers, taking a place in front of the room where everyone can see the flags they carry. As the Pledge of Allegiance begins, the veterans' voices are strong and deep, a baritone choir that can be heard clearly over the rest of the crowd. These men and women don't mumble or whisper or go through the motions. Their pledge is no empty ritual. It's a solemn oath, packed with meaning, a reminder of their deep loyalty to those who are left behind, a testimony to the steep price they have paid to defend one nation under God with liberty and justice for all. They salute or hold their hats over their hearts, standing ramrod straight at attention. Old shoulders that have been bent under the burden of eight decades are thrown back again. Their chins rise up. Eyes that have witnessed a lifetime of joys and sorrows, in war and in peace, are locked on the flag that means so much. For those few moments, they could be standing again on the parade ground at basic training, watching the colors being hoisted skyward through the morning mist at Reveille. The word hero is used all too cheaply today. The heroes to us are the veterans, and we need to remember that. Many veterans have said that going to war was a million-dollar experience, but they wouldn't give you a nickel to go through it again. Boot camp was a combination of fear of the unknown and excitement. And that appropriate description also summarizes the feelings of many in the crowd. Fear of the unknown and excitement. It puts the day into perspective. After boot camp, this will be easy.
I salute you for your service to our country, and I thank you for everything you have done and continue to do to make this country the great place that it is. Godspeed on today's trip and wherever life's journey takes you from here. Thank you very much.
The veterans receive a salute from Honor Flight Tri-State and silently return it. As the ceremony continues, we add a prayer.
As we begin our journey together, may God bless our trip today. May the sun shine, cool breezes blow, and the friendships begin as we bring our treasured veterans to see their memorials. Lord, please bless the guardians who have paid their own way, taken time off of work and away from their families to help us honor these brave men and women. And to our treasured veterans, may this be the beginning of a wonderful day filled with memories, and may you be blessed all the days of your life. You have given us the freedoms we now enjoy, so please let us take care of you today as a small gesture from a grateful nation. Lord, please hold in the palm of your hand those who have gone before us and have given the ultimate sacrifice, and protect those now serving our great nation today. And Lord, please bless all of the Honor Flight volunteers, board members, and medics who work so hard to make this a safe and memorable trip for our veterans.
As the moving ceremony continues, the American flag is slowly unfolded, and the poem Ragged Old Flag, written by Johnny Cash, is recited.
I walked through a county courthouse square. On a park bench, an old man was sitting there. I said, "Your old courthouse is kind of run down." He said, "Nah, it'll do for our little town." I said, "Your flagpole was leaned a bit, and that's a ragged old flag you got hanging on it." He said, "Have a seat." I sat down. "Is this the first time you've been to our little town?" I said, "I think it is." He said, "Well, I don't like to brag, but we're kind of proud of that ragged old flag. You see, we got a little hole in that flag there when Washington took it across the Delaware. And it got powder burned the night Francis Scott Key sat watching it writing, 'Oh, say, can you see?' And it got a bad rip in New Orleans with Packenham and Jackson tugging at its seams. And it almost fell at the Alamo beside the Texas flag, but she waved on, though. She got cut with a sword at Chancellorsville, and she got cut again at Shiloh Hill. There was Robert E. Lee, Beauregard, and Bragg, and the south wind blew hard on that ragged old flag. On Flanders Field in World War I, she got a big hole from a Bertha gun, and she turned blood red in World War II. She hung limp and low by the time it was through. She was in Korea and Vietnam. She went where she was sent by her Uncle Sam. She waved from our ships upon the briny foam, and now they've about quit waving her back here at home. In her own good land, she's been abused. She's been burned, dishonored, denied, and refused. And the government for which she stands is scandalized throughout the land. And she's getting threadbare and wearing thin, but she's in good shape for the shape she's in, because she's been through that fire before, and I believe she can take a whole lot more. So we raise her up every morning, we take her down slow every night. We don't let her touch the ground, and we fold her upright. On second thought, I do like to brag, because I'm mighty proud of that ragged old flag.
As the poem ends, the flag is fully unfolded and raised high over the heads of the flag team, then slowly passed, hand to hand like a blessing, over everyone in the crowd, first down one side of the room and back to the front along the other side. Everyone on this honor flight has a chance to touch it and pass it along in a moving ceremony that symbolizes how all Americans serve under the flag. Each hand that touches the flag unites veterans, guardians, Honor Flight volunteers and family members in an emotional connection. To some, the flag is a reminder of the country we love. To others, it might symbolize the ideals of an exceptional nation as formalized by Congress. White for innocence, red for valor, blue for justice, and stars representing our divine inspiration. For many veterans, it represents the sacrifices of so many Americans who have given their lives to make sure that our star-spangled banner still waves. As nearly everyone in the crowd wipes their eyes and clears their throats, the TSA color guard and the bagpipers lead everyone to the gate area to the sounds of pipes and drums.
Enjoy your trip today. It's going to be a great one. Enjoy your trip today. It's going to be a great one.
Just before boarding, there's another photo opportunity for veterans and guardians, and then everyone lines up to find a seat, supervised by Honor Flight Tri-State board members in red shirts, who are also the tour directors on each bus in the Capitol. Water is arching over the plane. It's a water cannon salute from the airport fire department. Such salutes are usually reserved for retiring airline captains and other dignitaries, but this one honors the veterans. We are off to Washington, D.C. The flight to Washington is short. We're ready to land. Our arrival at Reagan National Airport is greeted again by two airport fire trucks spraying another water cannon salute as the plane taxis to its reserve gate. Baggage handlers on the ramp and other airport ground crew members offer their own salutes. This is no ordinary flight arrival. Thank you. Now, we're ready to board the tour buses.
And the reason we carry that flag draped the casket of a World War II veteran who was supposed to go on a flight with us, and died 2 weeks before the flight. And his family gave us the flag.
Our first stop is the U.S. Marine Corps Memorial, known as Iwo Jima.
It was actually one of the guardians, and then one of the EMTs just sort of came up behind him.
Yeah, we made it last year for that dome. He had just taken this game.
In a few short minutes, we arrive at Arlington National Cemetery. It immediately commands respect and quiet contemplation. Arlington remembers. They rest in a place of highest honor. Generations apart in life, they lie shoulder to shoulder in death. The Challenger Memorial is close by. It's a beautiful setting. In springtime, Rolling hills and green meadows are sprinkled with the confetti of pink-white cherry blossoms that drift like snowflakes onto the headstones. Shaded here and there by ancient hardwoods, the linen-white headstones stand in ranks and files, an army of the dead on review. Looking out upon the lush trees and waves of green hills dotted with thousands of simple white headstones, it's impossible to be unmoved by feelings of sadness mixed with honor and deep gratitude for the sacrifice. All those beautiful sons, daughters, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, fathers, and mothers, each one was a blessing from God, a treasure to their family. The smile on their father's lips, the mist in their mother's eyes, the love of their spouse, the hero to their own sons and daughters. But now the light of love, life, and laughter in their eyes is shuttered, put out by a bullet or a bomb or a tiny split second of high-velocity steel that shattered a universe and sent shockwaves rippling through the world they left behind. The families that loved them and prayed that they would come home safely were never the same again. So many. What an incalculable loss. Arlington remembers. They rest in a place of highest honor. Their names a silent testimony to the price of American liberty. Even those who never made it home for burial are honored at Arlington. If the word hero has been devalued by athletes and movie stars, Arlington reminds us all of the real meaning of the word tragedy. By a strange arithmetic, every name in Arlington is a loss that diminishes us all, but still makes our nation greater. The veterans quietly moved to the tomb of the unknown soldier for the changing of the guard and wreath-laying ceremonies.
Reason. Oh.
The Air Force Memorial is the next stop. On the grounds of the newest of the Washington memorials, dedicated on October the 14th, 2006, by President George W. Bush. This prime location overlooks the Pentagon, the Potomac River, and all of Washington, D.C., offering a breathtaking view. Everything about this memorial evokes flight and draws everyone's eyes to the sky. The stainless steel spires are spectacular, graceful curves that trace the trails of jets soaring to glory. It's a lonely place. All that empty blue above the cloud seems to reach all the way to the outskirts of heaven. The sad emptiness is a reminder of all the pilots who never landed again at home. The design was based on the bomb burst formation of the Air Force Thunderbirds. The columns climb variously from 201 to 270 feet, with one plane missing from the formation, representing the missing man maneuver used for Air Force funeral flyovers. The memorial is surprisingly powerful, changing its appearance with the seasons and time of day, sometimes blue, sometimes mirror-like, sometimes stark in silhouette against the sunset. Nearby is a paved runway to glory at the entrance, a color guard depicted in 8-foot bronze statues, and a wall that bears the names of Air Force recipients of the Medal of Honor. On a wall, the three core values of the Air Force are engraved: integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all we do. The Air Force Memorial was dedicated the same year that Honor Flight Tri-State began its mission to honor veterans from World War II, 2006. The World War II Memorial started it all for Honor Flight. As they arrive at the main event of their trip, veterans are assembled for a group photograph. Here is a monument shaped like a medal for World War II veterans on a magnificent scale, as huge as a high school stadium. The round memorial is decorated with giant bronze wreaths and eagles symbolizing victory. Polished stars and fountains symbolize the loss of America's fine young men and the ever-flowing grief of their loved ones. Rows of pillars echo ancient temples. A larger fountain in the center of the memorial pulses with the living water of American freedom. The World War II Memorial is a marble and bronze eulogy for more than 16 million who served in the armed forces during the war and more than 400,000 who perished in the Pacific and Atlantic theaters. Worldwide, more than 70 million died in the Second World War. When you step inside, the memorial envelops visitors and takes them back in time to the Second World War, leaving the modern world behind. The sheer size of it makes everyone feel small, like the soldiers who fought during the war, supported by their fellow soldiers, but alone with their own feelings. Fountains at both ends of the plaza mark the Atlantic and Pacific theaters of the war. Between are relief sculptures on the walls that depict wartime scenes. Recruits getting physicals, combat, burial of the dead, farmers harvesting crops at home to support the war. Homecoming of soldiers. Above the plaza are additional columns supporting archways decorated with massive sculptures of American eagles holding laurel wreaths of victory. On the west wall, facing the Lincoln Memorial and the reflecting pool, is a Freedom Wall, decorated with 4,048 gold stars, each representing 100 American casualties. Each Honor Flight group stops and gathers to lay a wreath at the Freedom Wall of Stars, to remember all of the Americans who gave the ultimate sacrifice for their brothers and their country. There's a deep silence of sadness and memories as the veterans think of the friends they lost. Those were the real heroes. The memorial was a long time coming. It took more than 60 years after the end of the war to complete. With hugs and lots of tears, America remembers. The veterans stand in silence to honor all of the real heroes, those who didn't come home. The Korean War Veterans Memorial is just a short bus ride away. At the beginning, honor flights were nearly all World War II veterans, but as they have aged, more and more younger veterans are taking part. A typical flight now has more Korea vets than World War II. The Korean War Memorial is approached up a long sidewalk. It suddenly emerges as part of the landscape, almost lost in the woods, taking visitors by surprise. Ghostly silent soldiers in bronze sculpture patrol through bushes and ground cover in a park-like setting that suddenly seems haunted by a hovering threat. It's visible on the faces of the soldiers. They look lost, forgotten, their faces showing fear, stress, and anxiety. One platoon, all alone. 19 young troops representing the thousands of men who were sent to a strange, faraway land to fight a cruel war that was mostly ignored at home and quickly forgotten by their nation. They wear ponchos and carry rifles and radios, gesturing to each other, looking over their shoulders, scanning the ground ahead for threats, spread out, on full alert. The memorial demands silence and reverence. Conversations are almost in whispers. The bronze soldiers are 7 feet tall and represent various branches of the armed forces that served in Korea. A pool of remembrance is engraved with the words, "Freedom is not free." There are always fresh flowers at the memorial laid by Korean businesses or the South Korean consulate. The Korean people remember what America did for their country and are forever grateful. Many of the honor flight veterans of the Forgotten War say that when they visit, they can see for the first time that what they did was remarkable and is finally remembered and appreciated. The walkway is inscribed with the number of casualties of UN troops as well as American casualties, a simple reminder that Americans were not alone in the fight to save Korea. Images of soldiers and scenes etched into the wall come from thousands of photos taken by troops at the time, showing faces, war scenes, and equipment from all of the armed services. There are nurses, chaplains, airfield construction workers, supply depots, radio and communications officers, reporters, and even the canine corps. Two of the etchings show veterans from the Cincinnati area who were shocked to discover themselves depicted on the wall during their honor flight visits. Several honor flight veterans of the Korean War are chosen to lay a wreath near the flagpole that looks back at the soldiers on patrol. As the visit continues, the veterans also have time to visit the Vietnam and Lincoln memorials. The Lincoln Memorial fittingly overlooks both the Korean War Memorial and the Vietnam Wall. As he sits in repose, gazing out across the National Mall at those recent monuments and the World War II Memorial in the distance, President Lincoln seems to watch over the nation he held together by faith and willpower. Here is a face that has seen crushing sadness, but his expression is still loving and hopeful. Watching, waiting patiently to see if all the sacrifices, all the lives lost, were worth it. Does America remember? Does a grateful nation honor those who answered the call? Have we learned the steep price of freedom that must be paid so that this exceptional nation under God shall not perish from the earth? Lincoln is remembered for many things as our nation's 16th president. He signed the Emancipation Proclamation to abolish slavery and was assassinated before he could finish his second term. He was also one of our greatest war presidents, who led the Union in battle against the Confederacy and bonded together a country torn apart by its devastating Civil War. It was Lincoln who kept hiring and firing generals until he found one who could win, Ulysses S. Grant. It was Lincoln who started the healing even before the war was over, with his graceful and eloquent Gettysburg Address honoring all of the Americans who died in that July 1863 battle that claimed more than 50,000 lives. Some of the most beautiful views of Washington can be seen from the Lincoln Plaza. across the reflecting pool to the World War II Memorial, the National Mall, the Washington Monument, and the Capitol. The Vietnam War Memorial is nearly 500 feet long, containing the names of more than 58,000 who died in the war. Each name is etched in black marble that is polished to a mirror finish, reflecting the faces of those who visit, uniting the war dead with the living who come to remember them. Like the war in Vietnam, the memorial is unique and controversial, dipping below ground level into the depths of sorrow and despair before gradually climbing back up into the sunshine. In the shadows of the wall are the names of all the men who laid down their lives to build a human wall of resistance between freedom and communism. The black granite wall bends sharply at its lowest point, showing the strain and pressure that led to the eventual collapse of the American effort to save South Vietnam. The path alongside the wall is crowded with letters, photos, flowers and mementos left by friends and family members near the names of their lost loved ones. As visitors find the name they're looking for, many make a tracing of it on paper to take home. The entire wall cuts into the earth like a wound, symbolically following America's gradual journey deeper into the war than its gradual climb back out of Southeast Asia. The wall, as it is commonly known, has become timeless and popular. It is now the most visited memorial in Washington. In 1993, a sculpture depicting three women nurses helping a seriously wounded soldier was added in a grove of trees across from the wall, partly in answer to those who wanted a more representational tribute to the war in Vietnam. Like the Korean War Memorial a short walk away, it tells a powerful and emotional story of sacrifice, dedication, and sadness. Shade trees surround the memorial, one for each of the eight nurses who died in Vietnam. Some veterans of the Honor Flight have had sons who fought and died in Vietnam, and that makes the wall one of the more touching and moving stops in the tour. All those names, the veteran says, gazing at the wall as he fights against tears. All those names. The exhausting and emotional day is winding down, but most of the veterans are still going strong. As the buses take them to a buffet dinner, the excitement and camaraderie of the day creates a lively buzz of conversation and laughter around the dinner tables. Over fried chicken, roast beef, ribs, and lots of desserts, men who were strangers as the day began make friends and memories they will keep forever. Every veteran has heard the spoken thanks from a grateful nation. All of them have finally had a chance to see the memorials that were dedicated to their service and sacrifice. They felt the appreciation and respect from strangers wherever they went. Many who haven't been farther than the neighborhood grocery store in years have come to the nation's capital to be treated like conquering heroes. Thank you for your service. After dinner, the buses return to the airport for the flight home. It's after 10 p.m. by the time the flight lands back home, as all the veterans and guardians make their way to the arrival gate. It's been an 18-hour day for most, even longer for some. Everyone is anxious to get home to their families in their beds. But their Honor Flight has one more surprise in store. The Honor Flight ground crew has prepared a welcome home rally that looks like the homecoming for a world champion team, which is exactly what these veterans are. There are color guards, bagpipers, pinup girls, reenactors, military personnel, spouses, children, grandchildren, and well-wishers who don't know anyone on the Honor Flight but know they want to be there to applaud the returning veterans. The entire airport arrival area is jammed and overflowing with a cheering crowd. Signs say, "Welcome back, Grandpa. You are our hero." And, "We love you, Dad. Welcome home." The rock star welcome is a surging sea of smiles, tears, and hugs. It takes 20 minutes to wade through all the handshakes, kisses, and misty-eyed applause. The veterans are choked with emotion, overwhelmed. They can't believe it. Nobody can. "All this for us?" they ask again in wonder. The love, honor, and respect for these conquering warriors energizes the crowd like an electric current, pulsing in red, white, and blue flashes of pride. Tired backs straighten, old veterans stand tall again, drooping chins lift up, shoulders are squared away. They stare in disbelief, searching the crowd for their spouses, children, and grandchildren. They are greeted with hugs and wave after wave of applause. A group of pretty young women, dressed and made up for a big date, pinup girls, welcomes the vets with kisses that leave dark lipstick impressions. The Korean War veteran dives in like a man at a buffet of beauty, stealing kiss after kiss, laughing and smiling hugely. The years fall away. The ladies love him again. Here, finally, is the victory parade they never had, an outpouring of gratitude for a job well done. As the veterans melt away into the crowd, throwing their arms around their families, the cheers go on and on. While they make their way to their cars, their honor flight day has come to an end, but the memories will last forever. Honor Flight Tri-State thanks you for your service.